sorts of terrestrial being. Last week, we were really looking at how capitalism and construction were things that led to the rise of the skyscraper form and the desire that human beings have to be able to rise into the sky. Today also, we're going to really think about that desire, especially in the early 20th century, mankind had of thinking about breaking from its original boundaries, to be able to break rules, to be able to kind of fly free. But first, a quick sort of revision of last semester. Last semester, we looked at these sorts of cities. One second, I'm going to kind of turn the camera off so I can begin to stand. Last semester, we looked at these cities. And we looked at the kind of architecture that was happening in these cities at the end of the century. For example, we saw all of these styles that happened at the end of the at the end of the 19th and in the beginning of the 20th century. We saw the arts and crafts movement in England. This, of course, is William Morris's Red House. I don't know whether you all remember all of this, but anyway, you can go back to some of the earlier presentations and you'll find these ideas. The Glasgow style, this is something that we did not cover last semester, but it's an interesting style, especially the work of this architect called Charles Rennie Mackintosh, all belonging to the same sort of Art Nouveau world. We looked at the Vienna Secession and how that was contrasted later on by Adolf Loos's ideas of ornamentist crime. And we looked at the Art Nouveau that was happening in Paris and Brussels. And this is largely what we looked at last semester. There was another style that paralleled this particular kind of return to an arts and crafts aesthetic in Germany, that was called the Jugendstil, which is the youth style. And we'll come to this when we are looking at Germany later on. But the one that we are interested in right now is the one that started in, that was prevalent in Spain at that time, which has been known as Catalan modernism. The architect that, of course, becomes most famous for this style is the architect Antonio Gaudí. And we'll be looking at some of Gaudí's work itself and think about the idea of transcendence that is so deeply embedded in so much of his work. This style is also called Modernisme, with E at the end. So Modernisme, I don't know how you pronounce that in Spanish, but nevertheless, you'll find references to that kind of style in many places. But before we go to Gaudi, it's important to think about what are the influences that led to Gaudi. This is an architectural theorist called Violet Leduc. Violet Leduc is French, he was very interested in the kind of Gothic period of architecture. What he was really interested within the Gothic also was the expressive way in which structure works. He was really interested in looking at how the structure of these amazing cathedrals were able to create these architectural languages, and how there was a kind of close relationship between the material technologies available, which is, at a particular time, and how these lead to certain kinds of typologies, how these lead to certain kinds of expressions. If you think about it, this is exactly what Lewis Sullivan also was talking about last week when he was talking about form following function. So this relationship that Violet Leduc kind of really talks about the intimate relationship between material and structure and architectural expression, is an extremely important one for actually, all of modern architecture. Violet Leduc wrote a book called, I don't know how to pronounce this, so somebody who knows French might, but it's called Entretien, I guess, sur l'architecture, or Discourses on Architecture. It's this work that becomes very, very influential for many architects who are practicing in the late 19th and early 20th century. These are some drawings from that book. And here you're able to see the way that he's really thinking about the way that new materials like steel, for example, create their own sorts of modes of expression. Here you're able to see the market hall with the V-shaped kind of columns that are holding up the roof. And on the left, you see the kind of curlicues of the trusses that are holding up the floor. Antonio Gaudi was a Spanish architect. He lived from 1852 to 1926. He died in an accident, actually, on the streets, and was not recognized after he died until people realized that he's the great Antonio Gaudi. Nevertheless, Gaudi himself was highly influenced by Viollet-le-Duc's discourses on architecture. What we'll be doing is we'll be looking at actually his work and thinking about what led to it. And one of the important things that led to it was actually the idea of where he lived. That is the map of Spain that you're seeing in the top left. What you see in gray here is Portugal. This is what they call the Iberian Peninsula of Europe. And what you see in red is Catalonia. Now, Catalonia is a province in Spain, and it in many ways has a kind of disturbed relationship with Spain, pretty much like, you know, many of the districts in India have with the idea of India, whether that's Kashmir or the Northeast or Punjab sometimes, right? It has always had this long history, especially from the mid-1850s, where there was a big movement for Catalan independence. And this idea of an independent spirit separate from Spain was an important aspect in what shaped Gaudi's way of thinking. It was also important because the church, the Catholic Church, was also supportive of this idea of Catalan nationalism. Now, this becomes a very important one because in Gaudi's work, you see both of these strands. One, the idea of independent, kind of a secular new imagination for what it means to be European. And you also see a deeply religious sentiment in much of his work. Another important generator of the architectural imagination of Gaudi is the landscape. And these are the Montserrat Mountains that are just on the north of Barcelona, the main city within the Catalan province. And as you can see, these are spectacular mountains with a uniquely craggy outline that seem to inspire a lot of Gaudi's own architectural expressions. In fact, he even does a few projects within these mountains. We won't be looking at those. Did I lose it? Kya hua? Are you guys still on the slide? How does that work?
Yeah, we are on the slide.
So something's happened on my computer. Wait, let me get back to you.
Looking at the map of Barcelona.
Map of Barcelona. No, I lost that window for some reason. So the main city of the Catalonia province is the city of Barcelona. This was the oldest city of Barcelona, and until the middle of the 19th century, this is what it was, a fortified city, typical medieval structure, with a kind of little citadel on the bottom right, and a labyrinthine inner core. But in the middle of the 19th century, in 1855 actually, a new plan was imagined for the city. And in that new plan, by a person called Cerda, C-E-R-D-A, the walls were demolished and the city was imagined as expanding into the horizons. This is something, of course, the breaking of the walls at that particular period of time. We see happening in Bombay, we see happening in Vienna, we see happening actually around the world. We also see that this new city that is imagined as a grid. And this is a very interesting and unique grid that is particular and peculiar to Barcelona. It's a grid of square blocks whose corners are chamfered off to create these sorts of square nodes at each edge. And the roads are divided into there are a few primary and secondary roads that cut through it, but largely the width of these streets stays mainly the same. Yeah? And this is what they would call a typical Barcelona block. A Barcelona block would have the buildings set up to the edge of the entire block, and each building would create a backyard or a back courtyard that would then have the common gardens and facilities that this particular unit would share. This is an aerial view of Barcelona, and you can see the fact that the city stretches horizontally across there densely within that sort of fabric. It's literally like a fabric, like a piece of cloth. I'll skip this. So it is in this sort of environment that Gaudi works. And one of the first buildings that we'll see of his is actually a building that fits into the Barcelona block, which is building Casa Mia of 1906. Okay. And this is the building itself. Okay. As you can see, it actually is a corner building. It fills the corner of a plot. It is very, very expressive of, I don't know what it's expressive of, actually it's undulating as a surface. it takes the possibilities of its materiality, which is concrete, stone, and steel, and pushes it to be as expressive of an internal sort of dynamic as possible. What you're seeing here is an architecture that is tending to dissolve into nature, or architecture that is almost becoming nature. It's holding on to its architectonic, but it seems as if it's stretching and bursting from its seams to become nature. It's very apparent, especially when you look at the aerial view. Here you see the way that the building fits into the Barcelona block. You see the backyards that are green. The building actually fits perfectly snugly into the corner. It makes the corner. You enter from the corner, and the entire building is organized around two courtyards, right? A smaller courtyard and a larger courtyard. If you look at the building, if you squint your eyes and see, the building is actually a fairly conventional two courtyard type, right? You have a circulation system that is generally around the central courtyard, and you have rooms that encircle it with windows on looking out and apartments looking inwards. This is the section. I mean, you can see the fact that through the courtyard, yeah? And these are some views, and what strikes me as kind of amazing about his work is that sort of tendency towards naturalness. We spoke about the idea of the organic architecture when we were talking about Frank Lloyd Wright, and we saw some of the expressions that happened in Nari Gandhi's work and Bruce Goff's work in there. But in Gaudi's sense, it's as if nature has somehow kind of become architecture. And there's a profusion of color, of ornament, of twists and turns enabled by the new materiality that he seems to be exulting in. This is the view upwards from the inner courtyard. This is the stair within the courtyard that takes you up. You can almost see these like bat wings of these roof, right? So there seems to be a way within which he's looking at nature as a way of inspiring the structure as well as the form of the buildings. The roof, on the other hand, has these almost, I don't know what you can call it, like these monumental, iconic towers, and these towers conceal within them, you know, staircase shafts and things like that, right? But the way that he chooses to express them is almost as if there's a landscape of primitive beings that are sitting on top. Literally, some of them have almost heads of monsters or that are sitting on top. And you can see the fact that that sort of imagination of ornament comes very much from ideas of Gothic cathedrals that very often had these sort of grotesque kinds of figurines that took the form of gargoyles, etc., in these buildings. Yeah, another view of that. And here you can see the door that through which you kind of enter the staircase lobby that's there below. But for this kind of architecture, Gaudi really needed a patron who was willing to tolerate these excesses. And he found one in an industrialist called Güell. And Güell was one of, I guess you could call it, one of those Russic patrons of the arts. He was interested in thinking about, again, the idea of a Catalonian identity, as well as Catholicism, but as well as the idea of a certain kind of progressiveness that he needed to build, he needed to kind of express. So Güell was, of course, like I said, he was an industrialist. And one of the things that he did, if you think about it, is that at that time, there were many industrialists who were building cities for their workers. And he did, and that was considered to be a progressive thing to do. So Güell kind of designed or asked Gaudi to put together a workers' colony on the lines of like these British colonies that we already saw in the earlier, in the earlier semester when we were looking at industrial utopias. And the center of this entire new community was meant to be a church, a tiny little kind of church that was called the Santa Coloma. No, so I don't know what the name is exactly, but it basically is the, I don't know how to pronounce this actually. Huh? But basically it was the church at Colonia Güell in Barcelona. And as you can see here too, you see the extremely expressive way in which the materials are twisting and turning to hold up the roof of the building. You see the inside of the space. You see the plan. The plan is actually kind of, and this is the roof plan. So you are able to see the way that the load of the roof is being transferred down these members to these columns. And the columns themselves have these rugged, muscular quality as if they are carved out of natural stone that are pulling the load down. You see the section here, and you're able to see the fact that actually there's a flat roof on top, and actually the entire kind of play is in the space within. Another image of the interior. Another important project, again done for Guel, was this that is called the Park Guel. It's a park, again, that was meant to be part of a colony. The park was designed, I don't think much of the colony was. This is the park itself. Again, I'm just going to show you some images, because there's a terrace on top, and you kind of come up onto the terrace, which is, becomes a large public space from where you can see the city that cascades down there. Below that entire platform, there's a walkway. You can see the way that the arcade actually expresses the fact that it's holding up something. They are not vertical columns, they are diagonal, or holding up that entire roof. The roof itself has these ornaments that are all expressing some larger idea of nature, God, animals, etc. But of course, his most famous incompleted, not completed work, at least not in his lifetime, and I don't think it's even still complete, is the Sagrada Familia, the largest sort of church in the city of Barcelona. He was actually in the middle of constructing it or designing it when he was struck down by a vehicle on the streets of Barcelona, and he died. And it stayed unfinished for a long time. There have been many attempts that have taken his drawings and that have tried to recreate it. Many of those drawings were lost. So the legacy of Sagrada Familia is something that looms large over the whole of Barcelona. This is the frontal view of Sagrada Familia. You're able to see the fact that this is actually a reinterpretation in many ways of the Gothic, the long, tall, vertical spires that are leading into the sky, the flying buttresses, literally, that are holding up this entire entrance portico, and the completely mad kind of ornament that decorates almost every single surface of the building. This building seems to be more of like a kind of natural grotto than it does a kind of piece of architecture, and it looks like there are people, like, you know, there's a world entirely being created on the surface of this building. One has to think about this project, that this is being built parallel to some of the great modernists in Europe, right? 1926 is when Gaudi dies, and he's in the middle of building the Sagrada Familia. Although, of course, the design phase itself took a really long time. And correct me if I'm wrong, Shirish, have you been to Barcelona?
I have not. But I've seen pictures of both the Casa Mila on the inside and the Sagrada.
So there's a great film by Hiroshi Teshigahara on Antonio Gaudi. It's called Antonio Gaudi, where he just spends a lot of time, you know, kind of going over every square inch of the Gaudi buildings, and it's extremely powerful to watch.
Yeah,
but of course, even then, the Sagrada Familia wasn't completed. I don't even know whether it's completed now, actually. So,
no, I mean, it's, there are parts which are still under construction, it seems.
But I find that
the plan that you showed earlier of Casa Mila, as well as the some of the other plans, very fascinating. Okay, where the idea of the with the idea of the rationality that the modernist kind of planning was aspiring for. Here there was a different kind of a rationality where the grid is in many ways, it's an idea of a grid, you know, it doesn't have to be rectilinear for it to be a grid.
Yeah.
Okay. And I find that in Gaudi's work fascinating. There is an order, there is a clear structure, you cannot deviate from that. Okay.
Yeah.
So you're not going against those rules, but that doesn't mean that there has to be rectilinearity in that sense, you know.
For me, actually, you know, I'm interested, why I was interested in the, I'll talk about that one second. Let me just finish the images of the Familia that I have, so we can then, so what I love are these images, actually. These are the images which he designed the structure of the building, where he actually made an entire tensile imagination of the way that the load would get transferred and hung it upside down. So he's really looking at how gravity works, but he's looking at it upside down. So he's really thinking about every single member performing its role in transferring the load to the ground. So he makes these entire models and he hangs them upside down to figure out which members are in tension, what kind of joinery is required, etc. I love these images. They're just exquisite kind of models. Huge models, huh? extraordinary. Actually, in structures, it would be lovely to do things like this. Right?
Yeah.
This is the internal nave. It's like one madhouse paradise.
Yeah.
All of these images of these crazy colors, extraordinarily vertical, vertiginous, as they say, imaginations that are there. So what strikes me as really being amazing or incredible about Gaudi's work is at that time, like Shirish said, that this very idea of the rectilinear geometries and order is itself being problematized, but it's not being problematized such that it completely disintegrates. It's being problematized with this tension in the air, that it's straining at the seams, it's about to break free. And I was really thinking about how Freud, at a very similar time, is also talking about the idea of the unconscious or the id. It says that, you know, that there is a certain kind of ego that is at the surface that is trying to, in many ways, suppress or is mediating between the superego and the ego. It seems as if his work is very much like an eruption to the surface of many things that might have been otherwise been suppressed. It's like literally kind of coming to the surface, as if architecture itself has been the ego for the id of nature, where nature is trying to kind of strain through the structures of architecture to begin to kind of express itself. And that seems to be what's happening within Gaudi's work, right? So while Gaudi's work is training for a kind of transcendence into nature, into the world, and through transcendence into nature and the world, into, I guess, God, sublime, you have, at the same time, you have a sort of another movement that's happening in Italy that is called the Liberty style. And the reason I've marked Turin in Italy and not or something else is because this is the Liberty style, because actually the style, really the one of the most major events that happens in the evolution of the style is a large exhibition. You know, the exhibitions are such a big thing in the late 19th century and early 20th century in the evolution of architecture, that happens in 1902 in Turin, called the Turin International Exposition. The entire exposition was designed by this architect called Raimondo Tommaso di Oronco. And he, of course, later on became the architect even of Sultan of at that time Constantinople. But his architectural style, as it were, was definitely and decidedly Art Nouveau. If you look at the projects, that this is his main exhibition hall, you see the plan, you see the fact that it's very unlike Gaudi, actually, if you think about it. While in Gaudi's case, the structure itself was being distorted and becoming expressive, in this case, the structure itself is fairly clear. It's fairly straightforward. But the surface of this is decorated with these ornaments of sculptural women and mythical creatures and all these sorts of motifs that come from nature. In Gaudi's case, the nature will invade the structure. In this case, the structure is pretty much on the surface itself. Yeah? Within the exhibition, you have some of the great Art Nouveau and Jugendstil architects making architecture. On the left, you have Victor Horta, whose work we saw when we were looking at the Art Nouveau. He designs the Belgian Pavilion. On the right, you have Peter Behrens, whom we'll meet later, and making one of my favorite buildings, actually a factory in Berlin. But he's also coming from that, from the Jugendstil kind of system. And you can see the pavilion that he's designing. So in many ways, this is really a centerpiece of the Art Nouveau, as much as the 1925 exhibition in Paris that Shirish spoke of. Is a showpiece for the Art Deco style. But if you think about that kind of architecture, and you really think about what's happening in the world at that time, you have actually at that time an incredible array of movement that is happening. Suddenly people are no longer kind of stable. Distances are being traversed in much faster ways. On the left, you have one of the first electrical submarines being made. And of course, that kind of has a big impact in the war that follows. But you also have the first flight, and you have the first mass-produced vehicle that's happening, the car, the Ford Model T. You also have, at the same time, new ways of seeing yourself in the world. You have, for example, the idea of the telephone that is making voice travel distances that you never otherwise thought you would. You're able to look through people's bodies because of the new X-ray machines that were made. And Edison is also inventing the first reproducible light bulb that is suddenly making the night inhabitable. So what's happening is that you actually have these incredible machines that are transforming humanity radically. And at the same time, you have, you know, the Art Nouveau style that is, you know, doing this sorts of decorative prettiness on the surface, very often using materials that are emerging from the same industrial processes that led to these new sorts of inventions. Some of the great inventions of that time are ways in which we kind of begin to see. We are able to see things again. You have photography, for example, that happens. Now, this is a man called Edward Muybridge, who's really looking at the use of photography as something that can begin to document movement. He's thinking about the way that you can really understand the way, like you can know how many feet does a horse have on the ground at a single time when he's galloping. You can do those kinds of calculations because images of recording movement are able to give you the method of analyzing movement. Muybridge's images, of course, become very, very influential later on. This is when he's trying to figure out when does a horse actually touch the ground. He also does studies of people and men running, looking at what are the exact kinds of movements within it. So the image machine becomes, the image maker literally becomes a machine for recording and understanding movement. This is very simply the act of stepping on and over a chair. At the same time, you have another person called Etienne Jules Marie in France, who has invented a new machine. This new machine is actually a gun, but it's not a gun that shoots bullets. What the gun does is that it records images, and it records images through a machine gun-like mechanism that goes tuck, 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 and with every sort of movement of the trigger, it's recording a new image. And he is able to get these incredible images of horses moving, for example, or this one, which is a bird in flight, or for another one is this one, which is a man doing the pole vault. Yeah. And now, what was invisible to the eye, these movements are now made visible. This one, which is really checking out what does it mean to run? Or this one, this is just completely abstracted into pure line figures, again, the act of walking or running. And that is, of course, very close to the fact that it is exactly at this time that the first film ever made, it's in 1895, that is actually shown. These are the first cinematic images ever shown to a public screening. These are the images of a train entering a railway station. So with all these incredible changes, some of these are also directly leading to the making of extraordinary war machines. Like, for example, the similar sort of machinery that Mary was using to capture the movement of a horse or a person is being used actually for a machine gun. You also have the first sort of tanks being made at the same time. And all of these are going to lead to an incredible war that is just on the other side of the horizon. However, before that entire war, there was a group in Italy that looked at that work that we saw of the Liberty style and said, but the world is full of these incredible new machines and these incredible new ways in which we can live in the world. And somehow this architecture or this art that we are creating is just so damn old fashioned. They seemed to be inspired by that great philosopher, German philosopher, who's Friedrich Nietzsche. Now Nietzsche had this idea of the Übermensch. Übermensch is actually above man or Superman. This idea of the Übermensch was this idea that since God is dead, now at the center of our entire human enterprise will be man. And this man is going to be this person who has the ability to rise above morality and to create and impose new value systems in the entire world. In fact, the title of this lecture, The Will to Soar, comes from a statement by Friedrich Nietzsche, or an idea of Friedrich Nietzsche, which is the will to power. A group that called themselves the Futurists started in Italy. It consisted of, I guess, a multidisciplinary group. It had poets and architects and artists and sculptors and musicians and all of these people. These guys, there's not a single building built by the Futurists, but they are one of the most important architectural movements of the past century. it's quite an incredible thing, okay, because in many ways they represent all that is good and all that is horrific about modern architecture. We shall see soon. The main character who was in many ways the head of the futurists was this man who's called Filippo Marinetti. Marinetti considered himself a poet, but also later on decided that he was a politician, and he then became very, and these guys are very kind of right-wing nationalists. They're Italian nationalists. They believe in Italian nationalism, and they're very against the very imagination of the democrat. But to understand the kinds of features that really lead to this idea of the futurists, it's always amusing to read the manifesto, 1909. Okay. I'm going to read bits of it, and it's quite an interesting little kind of document. "We have been up all nights, my friend and I, my friends and I, beneath mosque lamps whose brass cupolas are bright as our souls, because like them, they were illuminated by the internal glow of electric hearts, and trampling underfoot a naked cloth on opulent Persian carpets, we have been discussing right up to the limits of logic and scrawling the paper with demented writing." So what is he setting up? He's setting up this room where him and his friends are hanging out underneath mosque lamps on Persian carpets. So there is that orientalization of this space, as if there's a sort of femininity around them that they are all trying to in many ways break against, but they are not able to. "Our hearts were filled with an immense pride at feeling ourselves standing quite alone, like lighthouses or like the sentinels in an outpost facing the army of enemy stars encamped in their celestial bivouacs, whatever. Okay. Alone with the engineers in the infernal stoke holes of great ships." So fundamentally, he's trying to say that in many ways, they're raging against this entire world, but they're not able to break out. Then later on, "Then we were suddenly distracted by the rumbling of huge double-decker trams that went leaping by, streaked with light, like the villages celebrating their festivals, which the Po in flood suddenly locks down and uproots, and in the rapids and eddies of a deluge drags down to the sea." And the silence increased. "As we listened to the last faint prayer of the old canal and the crumbling of the bones of the moribund palaces with their green growths of beards, suddenly the hungry automobiles roared beneath our windows." So as they're sitting in that kind of orientalized room, they hear these machines roaring outside. They see this double-decker going, they're like excited by that. And there he goes, Marinetti. "Come, my friends," I said, "let us go. At last, the mythology and the mystic cult of the ideal have been left behind. We are going to be present at the birth of the centaur, and we shall soon see the first angels fly. We must break down the gates of life to test the bolts and the padlocks. Let us go. Here is the very first sunrise on earth. Nothing equals the splendor of its red sword, which strikes for the first time in our millennial darkness. We went up to the three snorting machines to caress their breasts. I lay along mine like a corpse on its bier, but I suddenly revived again beneath the steering wheel, a guillotine knife that threatened my stomach. A great sweep of madness brought us sharply back to ourselves and drove us through the streets, steep and deep, like dried up torrents. Here and there, unhappy lamps in the windows taught us to despise our mathematical eyes. Smell, I exclaimed, smell is good enough for wild beasts. And we hunted like young lions, death with its black fur dappled with pale crosses, who ran before us in the vast violet sky, palpable and living. And yet we had no ideal mistress stretching out her form up to the clouds, nor yet a cruel young queen to whom we offer our corpses." So you see what he's doing here, right? From that, he's seeing these machines outside, these cars, and then the three of them go down and they caress their cars and they lie on it. The steering wheel is pointing to his stomach like it's a guillotine's blade. And then there they are speeding along the streets of that mythical city. "We drove on, crushing beneath our burning wheels like shirt collars under the iron, the watchdogs on the steps of the houses. Death tamed, went in front of me at each corner, offering me his hand nicely, and sometimes lay on the ground with a noise of creaking jaws, giving me velvet glances from the bottom of puddles. Let us leave good sense behind like a hideous husk, and let us hurl ourselves like fruit spiced with pride into the immense mouth and breast of the world. Let us feed the unknown, not from despair, but simply to enrich the unfathomable reservoirs of the absurd." Okay. Now, I won't read the rest of it. Oh, it's amusing. Should I continue reading the rest of it? It's very entertaining. So what happens later on in this entire thing is this, right? As he's speeding along, two cyclists he sees on the street, and what happens is to avoid the cyclists, he turns the car wheel suddenly, and the car goes and becomes upturned. now the car is not moving, so he's feeling a little bad. He calls his friends. His friends then, with his with help, turn the car over until it becomes straight. Okay. Then the car is not moving, and then the end. We thought it was dead, my good shark, but I woke it with a single caress of its powerful back, and it was revived, running as fast as it could on its fins. Then, with my face covered in good factory mud, covered with metal scratches, useless sweat and celestial grime, amidst the complaint of staid fishermen and angry naturalists, we dictated our first will and testament to all living men on earth. You can see the way that this entire, so he literally caresses the machine back to life. His body and the body of the machine are in an erotic embrace. It's like the machine is his lover, whom he is in many ways making love to, and as he's caressing that machine, which easy to make a phallic relationship here, the machine comes to life. In this very imagination, there is the thrill of danger. There's the masculinity of the whole enterprise, a kind of idea that there is a that there is a sort of exaltation in that energy. These are more sorts of sentences from the manifesto. I'll just read some of them again. The beauty of speed, for example. Courage, audacity, and revolt. There is no masterpiece that has not an aggressive nature. Poetry must be a violent assault on the forces of the unknown, to force them to bow before man. Time and space died yesterday. We are already living in the absolute. We have already created eternal, omnipresent speed, and the most controversial statement that they ever wrote. We want to glorify war, the only cure for the world. Militarism, patriotism, the destructive gesture of the anarchists, the beautiful ideas with kill and contempt for women. This is their text. And as you can see, this particular kind of masculine imagination that there is a sort of pride in being aggressive is deeply embedded within the Futurist Manifesto. Now let's look at some of the work. Very quickly, this is Bala. Bala is a painter. And in the painter, you can see that he's trying in many ways to capture movement. The entire idea of movement, this is called velocità and passaggio, whatever in Italian, velocità. Or in this one, which is one of the most famous ones, which really reminds you of those kind of photographs that we saw a little earlier, which are trying to capture the movement of a dog. In a painting, trying to recapture the dynamism of a dog on leash, which is the name of this painting. You also have sculptors like Boccioni. Boccioni's most famous work is this one. It's called Unique Forms of Continuity in Space. It's a very famous work, where you are able to see the body kind of dissolve into these fluid movements that are literally kind of dancing around the body. Body is literally kind of caught in a dynamic. A painting by him is this one. It's called The City Rises. You can see the wildness of the horse as is running wild within the red horse that is running wild within the city streets, and you can literally see the horse trampling over people and the faces in anguish, bodies distorted and about to kind of similar time. This is all 1910, 1913. That's when all of this is happening, pre First World War. You also have the idea of music, and this is a musician who's working with them as one of the Italian Futurist musicians. This is Luigi Russolo, and he wrote a famous what was called the Manifesto for Music. This is called The Art of Noise. It's useful to just kind of read in it. Russolo argues that the human ear has become accustomed to the speed, energy, and noise of the urban industrial soundscape. So he says now that music no longer has to be this pretty stuff with all these like lovely little kind of notes, etc. Music can be noise. And he sees noise as falling under these six categories: roars, thunderings, explosions, whistling, hissing, puffing, all machine noises. Whispers, murmurs, not voices, but whispers. Screeching, creaking, rustling. Noises obtained by beating on metal. So you have like, and voices of animals and people. Like, actually, as if the world's noises have become music. You know, music doesn't take a separate place. It's the reassembly of these noises into music. He also built a family of instruments that was called the Intona Rumori. And these are what the Intona Rumori look like. And he used these to make this music. What we'll do is we'll try and listen to a little bit of that music while I drink some water. You guys can hear, right?
Yes.
Goes on for a while. I won't play you the rest of it, but you get the idea. So as you can see, I mean, of course, this kind of idea of sound as music becomes very influential for the modernist kind of music composers for the next century, including avant-garde musicians like Brian Eno and a lot of pop and rock music, including Pink Floyd and people like that, whom a lot of you guys might listen to in the later parts of that century. But what of architecture? They had an architect who used to work with them, and his name was Antonio Sant'Elia. And Antonio Sant'Elia has made some of the most, I guess you could call it, influential drawings in architectural history. He came up with, like all architects do, the idea of an ideal city. This is a statement, we're just going to quickly read this. We must invent and rebuild the futurist city like an immense and tumultuous shipyard. As you can see, this idea of the city as actually a large factory or a machine is apparent in the writing that he does. And this is 1913, before Mr. Le Corbusier gets influenced and also talks similar languages. Agile, mobile, and dynamic in every detail. And the futurist apartment must be like a gigantic machine. The lifts must no longer be hidden away like tapeworms in the niches of stairwells. The stairwells themselves rendered useless must be abolished, because you don't need stairs, you have lifts. And the lifts must scale the lengths of the facades like serpents of steel and glass. The house of concrete, glass and steel, stripped of paintings and sculpture, rich only in the innate beauty of its lines and relief. Extraordinarily ugly in its mechanical simplicity, higher and wider according to need rather than the specification of municipal laws. It will soar up on the brink of a tumultuous abyss. The street will no longer lie like a doormat at ground level, but will plunge many stories down into the earth, embracing the metropolitan traffic, and will be linked up for necessary interconnections by metal gangways and swift moving pavements. Another statement, we have lost our predilection for the monumental, the heavy and the static. We have enriched our sensibility with a taste for the light, the practical, the ephemeral and the swift. From an architecture conceived in this way, no formal or linear habit can grow, since the fundamental characteristics of futurist architecture will be its impermanence and its transience. Things will endure less than us. Every generation must build its own city. So there is inherently within this idea the violence of a perpetually transforming youthness, young youth rather. And this idea of the youth as being someone that continuously challenges the old and destroys the old to make a new future. These are images of 1914, the new city, La Città Nuova, where you have housing. These are the external lifts that he was talking about that take you from below. And you, as you can see, the street is actually down there, down below. And these are the interconnected pathways that connect all these various towers. More images, this is housing rising into the sky. The street is here below with these speeding cars. More images. This is from the same. This is the railway station, if I'm not wrong, of the. Oh no, sorry. It's not a railway station. I think it's a station for aeroplanes. If I'm not wrong, maybe wrong. Extraordinarily dynamic kind of like look at the way that the towers reach into the sky, the way that the corners actually are, because you don't have any windows on the edge, the verticality is even more emphasized. In fact, the entire projects actually are about how the horizontal becomes the labyrinth upon which these towers rise and pierce the sky. We saw this, some of these images last week when we were looking at the Chicago skyscraper. But what's interesting is the aesthetic of this particular kind of architecture becomes extremely influential even in the Art Deco movement that follows, where you see the same kind of streamlining of balconies, of corners, of towers that are very greatly influenced by these. I would even suggest that much of Corbusier's influence when it comes to the idea of ship liners and boats that he was inspired by can actually be also traced to the futurists and their love of these machines. Yeah, I'm just showing some images because they are nice drawings, and I like nice drawings. This is the dam for the city. Naturally, the idea of the dam, these great machines, these big infrastructure projects, is highly influential, and of course they love all these big things because the more violent it is, the better it is. At least for Antonio Santeria. And we saw how these images become very, very influential, even for some of the stuff happening in America. These are images from 10 years later by Hugh Ferris that we saw last week, The Metropolis of Tomorrow. And you have, of course, images from that film that we referred to again last week, which is Metropolis, which is 1927. But what happens in 1914 when the war starts is that these guys are really excited. Dekho, war aa gaya. Now we can really do something. We can become the men that we always pretended we were. So they, of course, get very inspired by this idea of Italy and nationalism and all the great patriotic things they can do. And they very enthusiastically go to war. And once they very enthusiastically go to war, many of them die, including Antonio Santeria and Boccioni, that guy who did the movement, kind of the sculpture. Marinetti comes back. Marinetti comes back, and once he's back, he actually wants to be, he really becomes an Italian nationalist. He even joins Mussolini's fascist party. And he stayed a supporter of the Italian fascism through the Second World War. So what happens here in this case is that you're able to see the complicity, kind of violence, and this sort of masculinity in the creations of in the making of one of the most horrific episodes of the last century, which is the Second World War. A slight detour. This is not necessarily directly related to the futurists, but it's being built at the same time in Italy, and it's an architecture project that became very, very famous because of the fact that it was really an architecture for the car. This is a Fiat factory that was built in 1914, begun to be built in 1914, and built through the First World War. It's a factory that has an entire track on the roof for the testing of cars, and as you can imagine, that itself must have been an incredible invention. At that time, thinking, oh my God, car upar lekar, they are test driving cars on the roof. I'll just show you some images of the architecture. It is quite an incredible building, actually. These are images of the roof being used as a racetrack, being checked, where cars are being kind of checked. So there's a whole large loop that the cars are being driven on. And since this architecture is designed for an automobile, it becomes very, very representative of the idea that we don't need architecture for people anymore. What we need an architecture for is an architecture for machines. This, of course, is the ramp that takes up the car that you drive up to go to the roof. Another beautiful view of it and the structure. For some reason, the structure reminded me of the Gaudi structure. So I said, might as well put it there. The internal ramp, the roof, And of course, this is one of the most important buildings that Le Corbusier considered to be very, very influential in shaping his own idea of architecture. I don't think Giacomo Matte Trucco was directly involved with the futurists. I don't know. But it's interesting to think about the fact that as, and this is also in Italy, right? So as Marinetti and Santali are really discussing what the Futurist Manifesto is going to be, you also have an architect who's also in many ways designing an architecture for the car. And this obsession with speed, this obsession with a certain kind of masculinity, this idea of using the machine as a method through which one can transcend one's own body and transcend one's own being to break into, like, I don't know what is beyond the body, is an essential part of the way that actually so many Hollywood films also have looked at the idea of speed. I mean, this is Top Gun, Speed, and Fast and Furious. I guess each in belonging to different decades, the 80s, 90s, 2000s, I think, Fast and Furious, maybe 2010s also. So I found this really interesting to really think about the way that certain imaginations of masculinity are so deeply embedded within the architectural enterprise, that all architecture is in many ways an act of violence. And in this case, in the case of a lot of these architects, they treat the violence as necessary. It's necessary for us to be violent so that one can transcend one's own boundary and then break free into pure freedom, a pure freedom where morality, ethics, and women don't matter. What I found interesting about that, and why I put Gaudi and the futurists together, is because in both of these, I felt there was a willingness or a need to soar, to go, to rise above one's own bodily kind of inhabitation into the beyond. And we don't know what the beyond is. In Gaudi's case, it was the imitation of nature and the architecture that is invaded by nature, and the idea of light and soaring into the sky, into the divine, that seemed to determine his kind of architecture. While at the level of where the futurists, it was in many ways exactly the opposite. God was dead, and what we needed to do is not even have man at the center, because man in many ways was mere machine, okay? And women were holding him back. Women were holding him back, or the idea of the feminine kind of factor were holding him back from that kind of transcendence into his pure phallic kind of masculinity. And I find that, and this tendency that you have, these two kinds of tensions between different kinds of transcendence and different imaginations of the future, are something that we will encounter again, maybe next week. Next week, so while this is actually what we call the early 20th century Europe 1, next week is going to be early 20th century Europe 2, where we will be moving to the Netherlands and talking about what was the Amsterdam School and its actual mirror, the style, which is also in Amsterdam at, well, approximately the same time. That's all for me now. We can open for discussions and questions.
Yeah. I have a really short one before I go into my long question. Did every movement have like a signature dream city? Like, we've seen like so many ideas of this dream city or this utopian city, and like even Frank Lloyd Wright has his own utopian city. Like, what has been this inspiration for, like, you know, there has to be a city for this movement to like truly settle itself in history?
Michael had a line in one of his books. He said that the city is architecture's primal scene.
Yeah.
so it's like the thing for architects and architecture is the conception of the city. Okay, it's the highest kind of organizational problem of our existence, you know, in many ways. And it's one of those problems that has a materialist kind of existence, you know. So it's very much rooted in the structuring of material, okay. And that at the core, I feel, is the architect's sort of desire, you know, to structure material in a certain way, and city, it's its highest kind of object, you know. So that's what Shravan, that's my response, why every movement has a imagination of a city.
The city is representative of of civilization at its highest form. So when we are looking at architecture, there's always this idea, I mean, an architecture is also in many ways rooted in utopian imaginations. We are always building for possible better futures. So somehow the city, the ideal city then becomes that sort of end, the end piece that we are all aiming towards and never getting to. But we need to know where we are going, so we create these ideal cities, so we think that is where we need to go. So at least it gives meaning to the stuff that we do in our lives. Like the idea of democracy, it's an idealized imagination of who we are supposed to be. And everything that we do is an aim towards that. In the futurist case, it was this particular imagination of the city that was considered ideal. Well, you know, as you can see, not very politically correct at all, and not even very, not actually just a bunch of children, it seems like, you know, little boys playing with their toys.
Yeah, exactly.
Very talented boys and toys, but still.
I mean, comics have kind of clouded my perspective on this, but this literally seems like every, like, you know, second act where the villains have taken over either the country or a city, and they've, like, cut it up and divided each part into their distinct. And Joker's got, like, his own colors in, like, one distinct. Two-Face has, like, his theme going on in Arkham City. It just seems like very, like, supervillains have come in, divided the city. Old Man Logan, like, kind of also explored that.
Yeah, I love comics because of that, because they all have these strange... They have a way in which they are able to kind of build these other worlds, which are very, very reflective actually of our world today. Yeah. And our design.
Like actually, comics are a great segue into my next question, which is like this idea of like even in
Shravan, lecture, we see this Shravan, idea of. I promise I'll get to you, but I think Shyam has his hand up.
Yeah, okay? I'll go last then.
Yeah, we'll go last. Yeah, Shyam, bol rahe.
Hi, brother. Main bhi moment ke baare mein soch raha tha. Moment ke baare. तो मैं ऐसे थोड़े से छोटे मूवमेंट का कुछ टाइम के लिए पार्ट था. मतलब एक सुप्रसिद्ध हिंदुस्तान नाम से एक मूवमेंट चल रही है महाराष्ट्र में बीड़े गुट, तो उसके उसका मैं थोड़े दिन के लिए पार्ट था उनके साथ. मैंने एक मूवमेंट किया, तो मुझे अभी रियलाइज हुआ कि एक मूवमेंट में कोई भी क्या प्रॉब्लम होता है कि वो लोग लेके चलते हैं कि हमें पता है कि सच क्या है, तो हर बार मूवमेंट उसके वजह से फेल होता है कई बार. तो मेरे ख्याल से एक मूवमेंट की जगह पे ना एक मोमेंटम चाहिए जो हमें ड्राइव करे, ना कि मूवमेंट. मतलब हमें बस हम सर्च कर, मतलब हर मूवमेंट में मैंने जो देखा है दो तीन मूवमेंट उनको ऐसे वो कंसिडर करके चलते हैं कि हमें पता है ट्रूथ क्या है, क्या अच्छा है क्या बुरा है, और उसके पीछे बात करें. वो मूवमेंट का हर मूवमेंट का वो प्रॉब्लम दिखाया मुझे, और वो मतलब आर्किटेक्चर मूवमेंट में रिफ्लेक्ट होता है. पर उसके एक पैरेलल केस में जो वर्नाक्युलर हाउस की केस है, जिसमें वो लेके नहीं चलते कि अच्छा क्या बुरा क्या, वो हर जनरेशन के बाद वो फिर से आर्किटेक्चर क्रिएट करते बिल्ड करते, मतलब उसे क्या कहते हैं इवोल्यूशन टाइप, कि हर बार चेंज करते रहते खुद के आइडियोलॉजी खुद की सिचुएशन, और फिर वो जो आर्किटेक्चर बाहर आता है जो बहुत सारे इवोल्यूशन के बाद जनरेशन क्रिएशन के बाद वो ज़्यादा अच्छा आता है, और जो मूवमेंट में होता है वो बराबर उसके उल्टा होता है, वो अच्छा नहीं होता. ऐसा मेरा मूवमेंट के बारे में
हो सकता है. पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू है तेरा कि क्या है कि ये जो मूवमेंट का जो फंडा है ना, वो आर्किटेक्ट्स ने खुद पर डाला है. कि क्या है कि हम ऐसे लग रहा है आर्किटेक्ट लोगों को कि उनका जॉब है टू बी एबल टू शेप द वर्ल्ड. अभी शेप द वर्ल्ड में कैसे, मैं तो खुद नहीं कर सकता, मुझे तो जस्टिफाई करना पड़ेगा ना कि मुझे शेप द वर्ल्ड ऐसे करना है क्योंकि मुझे मेरा ये बिलीफ है, मेरा रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी दिया है वर्ल्ड ने, ऐसे लग रहा है आर्किटेक्ट लोगों को कि मेरा रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी डिसाइड करना कि व्हाट इज गुड फॉर द वर्ल्ड एंड हाउ आई शुड पार्टिसिपेट इन इट. तो इसीलिए वो मूवमेंट कर लेते हैं, पॉलिटिकल मूवमेंट, आर्किटेक्टोनिक मूवमेंट, आर्किटेक्चुरल मूवमेंट, जो भी है. लेकिन एक भी है कि वो फॉर्म का जो है ना मूवमेंट में जो फॉर्मल एक्सप्लोरेशन होते हैं बिकॉज ऑफ दैट, वो कभी कभी नए हो सकते हैं. वेदर इट्स अ गुड और बैड इज अनदर स्टोरी, बट समटाइम्स दे आर एबल टू ब्रेक सम अर्लियर रूल्स दैट आर देयर. That becomes something that we are excited by. Now, what is important, I think, I agree with you in almost every way. But I keep thinking that this romantic idea that we have of the vernacular, ki ye vernacular hai to acha hai kyunki wo purana hai kyunki wo sab hai, lekin yaar main kabhi kabhi sochta hu ki vernacular itna acha hai kya, kyunki you see, if I go to an older Indian village, in the vernacular caste is still there. Women are still relegated to the back of the home. I can still see the fact that the vernacular is based on the fact that that a particular caste of people is relied on to collect shit. None of that has changed. How do you change that if you kind of continue to believe only in the vernacular? How does transformation happen? How do you bring entire histories? I know history's weight is there, bahut bada hai. Like centuries, these things have lasted. How do you transform that? Do you trust it to transform itself? Or do you say that no, they can't transform itself because these are too deeply embedded and power is going to continue to be with only certain kinds of people. And they are going to only have their agenda run through. So how do you change that? Can you do that by only trusting the vernacular, or do you need the violence that the futurists, in many of the ways, stupid ways, try to think about? There's a question. I don't know. What do you think?
मुझे पता नहीं आपने वो किस हाउस के साथ रेफर किया वर्नेकुलर हाउस, पर मैं एक हाउस में रहा हूँ, मतलब छुट्टी के लिए रहता था, तो वहाँ पे मैंने देखा है कि वो जो मतलब मैंने देखा है कि विलेज का जो फेमिनिज्म है ना वो काफी अच्छा है. बट मतलब अगर एक घर में जेंट्स अगर काम मतलब क्या करते उसे उसका कर्तव्य तो नहीं है कुछ, तो वहाँ पे लेडी टेक चार्ज और वहां से वो सारा कंट्रोल करते हैं. और वो इट्स वेरी कॉमन, मैंने बहुत घरों में देखा है कि जो भी डिसीजन होते हैं अगर गांव की चर्च है तो वहाँ पे घर की लेडी जाती है ना खिलर, और जो पड़वी रहती है जहाँ पे सारा डिस्कशन होता है उसके साइड में किचन होता है, कि अगर कोई भी डिस्कशन घर का हो रहा है तो उसमें एक मतलब औरत भी उस डिस्कशन में रहती है. तो वो एक मैंने वर्नेकुलर हाउस में देखा, और एक ही हाउस में देखा
मैंने उल्टा भी देखा है. हमने जब यहाँ का स्टडी किया था, विलेजेस का स्टडी किया था, तो हमने ये देखा था कि पूरा विलेज का स्ट्रक्चर वॉज बेस्ड ऑन कास्ट एंड दलित कास्ट वर ऑन द आउटस्कर्ट्स ऑफ द विलेज एंड नॉट अलाउड एक्सेस टू द सेंटर ऑफ द सिटी. दे वर गिवन द वर्स्ट पॉसिबल. आई हैव मैप्स दैट शो दैट एक्चुअली. सो एंड आई एम एक्चुअली थिंकिंग दैट इज दैट ओके एंड इफ ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन. हाँ देखा है अभी भी. मैं किसी भी स्लम में जा, अभी भी तो जाएगा तू तो, या गार्बेज हमारा जो गार्बेज डंप है बम्बई का, वहां जा. और अगर तू वहां का स्टडी करेगा तो वहां तू रियलाइज करेगा कि 90% ऑफ द पीपल हु डू द वर्क विद इन द गार्बेज डंप आर पीपल बिलोंगिंग टू द दलित कम्युनिटी एंड द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बीइंग प्रोवाइडेड टू देम इज नथिंग. Even today, like I'm not even saying that, you go and see, it's there. You'll see the blue kind of Buddhist flags across that whole landscape. So I mean, I understand where you're coming from, right? I understand that there is a certain way in which we like to believe that the vernacular or the traditional is beautiful and it's ideal. I'm not saying that it's not. I'm saying there may be many things that we can learn from the vernacular. It's possible, like there's some incredible things that are there. I mean, I love old buildings. The scales are gorgeous. Very often they use material beautifully, and they are very climatically responsive. They may be more sustainable than any new buildings. All of that may be true, but they also are based on certain kinds of practices that we might want to rethink. One should not expect, my own thing is simple. Okay? I don't think one should work with categories. Vernacular hai, modern hai. You know, I think those all categories themselves are very problematic. The real category I want to kind of work with, which I think is useful, is that is it going to make lives better? Is it going to be responsible? And if you believe that that's coming from vernacular kinds of architectural systems and traditions, so be it. If it comes from the futurists, so be it. I mean, I don't think one should believe in a movement. One should believe in the action. नहीं तो हम ideological बन जाते हैं कि अच्छा है क्योंकि मैंने बहुत देखा है. मैं बता रहा हूँ ना, ये जो राज रेवाल आर्किटेक्ट है, पता होगा तुझे, उन्होंने एक यहाँ एक न्यू बॉम्बे में एक हाउसिंग कॉलोनी बनाया है जो एकदम vernacular स्टाइल से इंस्पायर्ड है. किसी को वहाँ रहना नहीं है क्योंकि वो बिल्डिंग्स आर डार्क डिंजी एंड द वॉल्स आर फुल ऑफ डर्ट बिकॉज ही यूज्ड अ सर्टेन काइंड ऑफ रस्टिक फिनिश दैट नोबडी कैन मेंटेन. So I think, Shyam, it's important to kind of keep that in mind, that one can learn from everywhere rather than think that one has the answer in a particular style, whether that's new, old, whatever that is. Is my opinion. But it's a good question. Anyone else wants to kind of has a reaction? It can be anything, huh?
Yeah.
Like Shyam's reaction was nice because he was really thinking about it through a different lens. We didn't pick there's somebody who's raising his hand.
Atharva.
Usual suspects. We need to kind of have new people, man. This is getting ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know how to put this in words, but you told the history of Gaudi, like he's from Catalan. They had their sort of freedom struggle and also had a religious background. So like that type of a modern, I won't say modern movement, but something like that of Gaudi and what we learned in the previous semester of Golconda. So I was thinking like a religion and the fight for liberty, something like that, how religion, religious values make transform the idea of modern, something like that. It was going in my mind.
No, that's a good, it's a big religion and modernism have always had a very awkward relationship. Right from the time of somebody like Galileo, who got into the wrong side, or the Copernicus, didn't he? Who said that the world is round and the church said, yeah, No, the world is flat, for God's sake. So there's always been that sort of tension between the scientific, secular and the religious. What a lot of times happens in, especially within secular circles like ours, is that religion gets transferred into spirituality. That we remove practices of religion and we say, nah, everything is the same at the spiritual level. When actually religion is also practices. So we try and kind of deny practice and say that no, at a deeper level we are all one. It's also a tactical move, actually. It's a tactical move by the democratic nation to embrace different religious practices within one imagination. I think it's, you know, I am not religious by nature, but I think more and more, and especially when I was younger, religion was something that I avoided. Actually, it didn't interest me. It wasn't something that, because it was not part of my life. Even my family is not religious. But more and more over the past few years, I've realized that religion plays such an important role in shaping the way that people work in the world or people live in the world, that it would be naive and stupid to deny its importance in shaping people's senses of who they are and senses of right and wrong. So I think there's respect necessary to be able to really talk about religion without really, but at the same time, one has to deal with religion through a secular lens. One has to think about it as practices. And one should not kind of get into the mythology business. Krishna yaha tha, Ram yaha tha, and all of that. One should say that people believe that Krishna yaha tha. You know, the difference between the two things is important. Because one is reliable. It's a reliable fact that people believe that Krishna was here. It's not a reliable fact to say that Krishna was here. So it's an important thing for me to make that. At least that's the way I work. I am not religious by nature, so that's what I do. That's what I do because I'm interested in religion, but I'm not religious. But I know many of you might genuinely believe that Krishna was here. And in that case, the way that you would approach your kind of projects, etc., would be very, very different.
But I'm interested in how we build myths as well, you know? Like, while there is such a thing as the religious aspect to it, there is also an inherent way by which we construct myths for ourselves, and I think there's something of interest there, and I find that in many of these now that you look at many of these manifestos, they were also trying to create myths for themselves and project them into future. I see a lot of it like that, huh? Now that, yeah, I'm looking at it. I mean, of course, they are part of our history now, so that changes things. But religion is very confusing. I think I've been very disillusioned after I started a family of my own. increasingly more disillusioned than how what I was before. Okay. And I'm not able to reconcile how you can, I mean, that the fact that you can behave quite bad with people and still say that you are actually very clean and, you know, very biased.
And you do it because you say that you're very religious, that you can be very bad with
be
people.
Very bad.
Very strange.
Yeah. And that's really, that just doesn't just doesn't fly in
fit
in the, and my idea of rationality is constantly sort of battered by that kind of behavior and you see all around us, right?
Yeah.
So
it's true.
That's very confusing.
Anyone else wants to kind of say something, or is it always going to be these?
What were you saying? You mentioned something where it actually sounds from large cathedral organs blown through the train or a ship horn. Okay.
Yeah, like he was trying very hard to make it sound industrial, whereas
it's true.
I actually had a question that like Sagrada Familia's construction started in 1800s, but the architect is no more. And why are they still like it has the construction has been going on for centuries now. So isn't it like if we look at it from a capitalist point of view, isn't it a drain of resources? I mean, the project was the architect's vision itself. And he would have been the one who was devoted if he was still alive, but after his death, it has been so many years. Then why not conclude the project? And what is the motivation? What must have been the motivation behind keeping it going?
Money. Also religion, you know, the fact is that a lot of people go to Barcelona because it has this iconic building. Na? It's what they call the Bilbao effect. Like when Gehry designed his Bilbao Museum in Bilbao, Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao, suddenly the economy of the place went up because everybody ran to the place to get to see that amazing, strange building. I mean, that could be one reason.
But it is still open to visitors, right? Even when it is not completed.
People
still visit it.
Yes, so it's a waste of money, you think, to kind of complete it. But it just might be the most amazing, beautifully made building ever. Don't you want to see the Taj Mahal completed? Or should we leave the door unfinished?
But I mean, I think it still looks like too grand and beautiful as it is.
Yeah. Imagine when it's finished. It's quite a crazy building, I must say.
Yeah.
You do know that the rocket temples at Kailash took 400 years to build, right?
And I
always wondered that what must have sort of kept that project going, and I think religion is one of those things that keeps the project going, you know. And we might find several such examples of see that the conventional capitalist logic will not play over there. There is a belief, there is a sentiment attached to it for which people will want to keep that project going rather than closing the project in many ways. Although there are places in, where is that place in France where an entire town used to believe that there were remains of Lady Mac, some lady, someone's, Jesus' mother, right? Remains of her hair or something were supposed to be in this particular.
Isn't it there in that cathedral?
No. And in the cathedral, in a village where the whole village grew around that. And then later on they found that
Is it Lourdes?
No, I forget the name. And later on they found that the remains are actually somewhere else. Okay. So what happened, that village was deserted actually over a period of time. And so there are many such incidences also. I'll tell you, we'll find out where it was. Yeah, 400 years is several generations who saw it in different stages of development.